All right.
I've hit record, which is nice. So we're now recording. Stream Machine, episode 51. The first episode of many to come now for what will henceforth be known as season 2 of Stream the Machine. Starts now.
Call an ambulance, please.
Okay, hold on. Where does it hurt?
My stomach. ちゃんと痛いけど痛い。
救急車を呼んでもらったからといって安心はできません。しっかりと自分の状態を相手に伝えましょう。
I have a bad case of diarrhea.
私はひどい下痢です。
I have a bad case of diarrhea. I have a bad case of diarrhea.
I have a bad case of diarrhea. I have a bad case of diarrhea.
Science Productions Podcast. Welcome to Stream the Machine.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Stream the Machine, Season 2, Episode 51. So a friend sent that to me, and he was like, yeah, you should totally play this on the show. And I was like, actually, I have a clip that I've played on the show before, this one here.
I have a bad case of diarrhea.
And I had no idea where that ever came from. I like, when I first started the podcast, I had found, like, some, just like a random radio show clip thing. And it had, like, a whole folder full of all these just weird stuff, and then I had a bad case of diarrhea as one of them, and so he sent that to me, and I'm like, dude, this is like the origin story, like this is where it all began. So I was like, I gotta play this.
I was rolling. And then, was that a new intro song?
It was. So I got together with a guy I work with, and told him over the break, I was like, hey, you know what? Let's go ahead and surprise people. Let's do a new theme song for season 2. And what happened with that one is I actually waited a little bit too long to do any voiceover for it. So it's actually a little bit longer than I'd like. And so I'm going to get with them this week and try and cut it down a little bit. I really liked some of his electronic music, and he actually will be featured on today's show. So not as a guest, but his music will be in both of our slots, and we will get to hear some of his other work. But so the idea was we were going to sit down, going to record some like guitar, and then some of his and have him, you know, do sort of the mixing and the producing and have him do like some electronic stuff with it. But my interface for my guitar is a piece of shit, so it didn't work very well, and it was causing some input lag, and it is impossible for me to play guitar and try to listen and play if there's even like a slight millisecond of input lag. So that we had to scrap the guitar idea completely and instead just went with him doing a fully electronic thing. But yes, that is the new theme.
I didn't know about this, but I do like it. But I thought for a second that you had your friend remix I Have a Bad Case of Diarrhea into a full song, and I was like, oh no. I was like, that's what I thought was coming.
No, yeah, I saw you laughing, and I was just like, he'll get it when I announce the show. It went so well together hit it. It was like, oh shit, like it's getting ready to drop.
That's what I thought was coming.
So, no, he was the guy who did the ice cream, chocolate ice cream remix. Yeah, so, if you're tuning in today, if you're listening, and it's if you're listening on MixLR, which it doesn't say anybody is, so I guess that's kind of a good thing. We have a new method that we're using to sort of interact with the show. Got some good feedback over the break from some people, and a lot of people surprisingly thinking that the show was over. So I don't know if no one listened to the finale episode or whatever, and was just like, "Oh God, they're done," and didn't pay attention. We were coming back. We're back now, but a lot of people were like, "Oh, well, the show is really good, man. I'm sad it's over." Good work, though. Congratulations on a year. And I'm like, bro, we're going to be back in 3 weeks. Relax. We're coming back. We're not done. We're never done. Nope. No, but so we got this new... One of the feedback things I heard was a gentleman I used to know who said, you know what? I love listening to the show, but there's a lot of times that maybe you guys all agree on a subject, on a topic, you know, if we're talking about something important. Mm-hmm. And he was like, you know, I've really wanted to present you with an opposing idea or an opinion. You know, what if this? You know, if you guys are thinking A, well, what about B? What if B? And, you know, he was just like, with the current way the show works, there's not really a great place aside from the Twitch chat, which you guys don't seem to use much. And he's correct. We didn't use the Twitch chat because having Twitch up and running while we were running the stream or trying to stream would just kill our bandwidth, and the show would then sound and look like crap. However, we found a basic Java program that actually connects with the Twitch feed, and we don't actually have to stream the video for it. So we've got a direct link. We all three are sitting in the chat room today. So if you are listening anywhere else other than Twitch, log on to Twitch. Try to get on Twitch. If the Twitch video feed is not working for you, go to Twitch's website, go to our channel, pause the Twitch stream, load up the audio on MixLR, but go ahead and talk to us on Twitch, because that's where we're all going to be. MixLR does have a chat feature, but Twitch is where it's going to be at from now. Shout out to what looks like my buddy Michael and my friend Sarah, who are also in the chat room, so thank you for listening in live. Now that we've got all that out of the way, let's get back to our usual crap. Normally this wouldn't really be that big of a deal. I wouldn't I do mention sometimes when I watch really great movies, like The Crow, mm-hmm. I mentioned that, John Wick, I mentioned that. I watched the Hellboy series over our little break. Loved it. I've never seen Hellboy, and specifically had never seen Hellboy because I just didn't know what to expect. I was like, Ron mm-hmm. Perlman is this like half demon dude or whatever he is, like, and I had barely seen trailers, had like not really like really sort of investigated any of it. I just was like, that looks like it could just be weird and dumb. So I never watched it. And then on a whim, I was kind of looking for something different and decided, you know, I'm going to sit down and watch Hellboy because I want something quirky, and I want to watch something that I'm not sure I'm going to enjoy. You know, I want to be experimental. And as it turns out, hold on one moment here. As it turns out, I loved it. Absolutely loved it. Like, loved it so hard that I want more Hellboy right now. Watched the first one.
And the second one?
Yeah, watched the first one and immediately was like, you know what? I have to watch the second one. And so I watched the second one and enjoyed that one just as much, if not maybe a little bit more, because it got a little bit more like into the whole monster side of everything. I think they dealt with a little more of like the fantasy vibe that Hellboy had. Yeah. Whereas the first one, I'm trying to think. The second one dealt with the Golden Army, and so you had like the elves and then all that stuff. And I'm trying to think what the first one was about. Who they had to? Who was their main bad guy in the first one?
It's been so long since I've seen him, but he's trying to use his big hand to like destroy the earth. It was like part of a key or something.
Yeah.
Who was that bad guy? Was it the Nazi?
It was Rasputin. So Rasputin, yeah. Like the old evil mage or whatever, got resurrected. It's good.
The guy who with the leather, the gimp suit, and the sharp things.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Scared the heck out of me as a kid. Like,
he's a crazy dude.
He's scary.
Yeah, very in. Oh, I mean, like, and he's like made out of sand and stuff, or like bone dust, or whatever the heck that stuff was. Was definitely a crazy, crazy dude. Really enjoyed it though. Turns out there's animated films as well. I think only a couple. All voiced by the same cast. So it's something else I want to check out, because that sort of like helps my immersion factor. Like, if I watch a movie and I see the actors, and then you see that the actors come back for the animated stuff. So I definitely want to check those out. Just was shocked at how... Because this, like I said, this was a series that I had not watched because I thought it looked so dumb. I was like, this looks like it's going to be awful. And it turned out to be something that I deeply regretted not watching sooner. Mm-hmm. From what I've seen, it looks like Hellboy 3 is... very up in the air as far as like whether or not it's ever going to be made. So the first one barely made their budget back, but reviewed very well, like high 80s on Rotten Tomatoes. Same thing with the second one. Second one made more of its budget back, but made all of its budget and a little bit more back. Also reviewed very, very well. Like, both of these are highly, highly rated films for being essentially comic book movies.
Obscure comics at that.
Exactly, yeah. They're just not sure about a third one for, I guess, maybe they're not making enough money back on them. But, I don't know. Just, it saddens me because, it was great. I'll tell you what, I don't have this on the notes here, but I will tell you, I started to watch Pacific Rim. Kind of on that same thing of like, you know what, this also looked really dumb, but maybe it will be kind of dumb and cool, and you know, it's robots fighting monsters.
That's the exact thought I had.
I did not like it one bit. And I've got like a good friend who was like, what, I loved it, and he was like, it's just robots fighting, and I don't really
exactly
care. Right, well, I don't really like robots or whatever. That's why I don't really watch Transformers, or why I really wasn't into Pacific Rim. But I like monsters, and I like big monster fighting. And so I was like, maybe that will be enough. You know, maybe the monster part of it will be enough to draw me in. It was not. I every part of it, I just was... didn't... I can't think of one part of it that I actually enjoyed. Like, I think it's just... like a genre clash with what I prefer, because I know a lot of people who were like, yeah, no, I really liked it, but didn't work for me, not at all. So I'm not saying it's a bad movie, I'm just saying for whatever reason it was not my taste, which is unfortunate, because
when they're like almost in outer space and takes a giant sword and just like guts the thing in the midair,
and you know what, I didn't
like that.
You know what I thought at that moment? I go, why the hell haven't you been using that sword the whole time?
Because the kaiju blood is toxic, and if it gets blood everywhere, it's like acid.
Okay.
It's like electric.
Fine. Core. You know what? That's a better excuse than what I had, which was, oh, they just wrote it in here. Let's give him a sword. Like, it was pretty sick though, because he like whips it out, and it's like, yeah. Isn't it like kind of like loose, like a whip or whatever, and then just and it like
straightens
rigid?
Out.
Yeah. It was really neat. But other than that part, I don't think I was really sold on much of it. So other than those two movies, I'm trying to think of like the biggest things I really did over this break. Started watching Supernatural. So I don't,
far?
I don't, think 10 episodes maybe.
Okay.
So it was just this week that I started watching Supernatural. So I'm barely into the first season. I like it. I like it a lot, actually. I like... it's kind of the reason... one of the reasons I really liked Hellboy is I like Monster Hunter-style fiction. Or, you know, like, I like watching people hunt down creatures. And so that's, you know, that's kind of the reason I watch Pacific Rim. I like watching people just fight monsters and try to take them down. And it's 100% what Supernatural is. I didn't realize that before. Before I had read a little bit about it having like some Norse gods in one season, I was like, oh, so it was kind of on my radar, but didn't know much about it. And I was like, if it's just like dudes encountering, like, you know, and I had a little reservation because it was on CW and just, but it's good. It's like surprisingly, the first season at least so far is like surprisingly dark. And the first season was on WB, and I'm not sure how disconnected the WB and the CW are. So I don't know if season two, which is when it moved to CW, I don't know if it got like any lighter, but I don't know. There's a couple moments for being like a TV 14 show that I was like, oh damn, like,
yeah,
it's crazy. Like, yeah, like
go a little deep, go a little dark.
But it's good. I like it. A friend had recommended me. He was like, well, if you like that kind of crap, watch Grimm, which I don't know what network that's on.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
But
I think that's more like primetime, like ABC or NBC.
Right,
or
I think so too. And I imagine it probably doesn't have as much of leeway with being able to show blood or whatever. But I'm enjoying it. So how far
next Supernatural? I've seen all of Supernatural except for the season airing now.
Okay.
You just wait until it's on Netflix. But I like, because they, like, pretty much, like, every monster you've ever heard of is actually real in this universe. So, yeah, like,
it's very cool.
Conflicting religions, doesn't matter. All the monsters, every single monster is real.
It all exists, and it's going to try to kill you.
Yep.
One of my favorite parts is, with the journal that the father has left behind, because that's like, so when you talk about like monster hunting, one of my favorite parts of that like genre, that style, is when they're like, a freaking catabolepis, well hold on a second, and they're flipping through the book and they're like, ah yes, that's so and so, and it's got a weakness of garlic, and they like read through all the stuff and it's like all there, and I love that. Usually it's a big old tome that they got in the library. But this is like, oh, their father wrote this journal, which is, you know, whatever. But he's apparently got all of the monsters ever lived. It's all in this journal, and it's really cool. I'm really like eating it up when I watch it. It feels like in some ways it kind of like delivers on a weird like X-Files format, because X-Files is kind of a similar thing. They're like, they're investigating these, because it's very detective like. You know, they're having to show up, pretend to be cops, and like, how did this guy die? Well, that's weird, because what about this man? And, you know, and so they kind of, X-Files was the same way. You show up, somebody got killed by something weird, and they're trying to figure out, you know, is it actually a creature, or, you know, an alien, or is it actually, you know, a human? And and I'm a huge fan of the X-Files. It's a good mix of, like, all this crap that I really like in Supernatural, so...
Yeah, I just started X-Files actually recently. I'm still in season one though.
Awesome. It's a very long show, but
I know.
It's good, man. There's
a lot in front of me.
It's oh man, it's so, those are 45-minute episodes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. And it's especially long, cuz I think that was back when they probably had like 20 some episode seasons.
Something like that.
So yeah, if you think about it, you're watching like 20 hours of material just to watch one season. Where these days, you get like 13 half-hour episodes in shows, and much shorter than it ever used to be. But
another thing I watched over break, Daredevil.
Okay, so that's on my list. It's on my list. I haven't.
That is. It's part of like the Marvel Cinematic Universe, like part of that universe, but it's a completely different tone.
Yeah, that's what I've heard.
It's just like, I'm gonna go just beat the pulp out of this crime dude and just leave him there. Like,
yeah,
I'm not gonna kill him, but I will beat him with an inch of his life, and just from then on, it's all his. It's all up to him.
Like pretty dark and gritty, and that's kind of what I, and people would be like, oh dude, that one scene where he just destroys everybody in the hallway or whatever, and like all this, like just a lot of reference to him just crushing dudes like in combat, and so I'm like, it's on my list.
This scene is like my favorite scene.
It's on my list.
Bump it up on your list.
I need to. You had a race over the break. or like racing quotes, because I never know if a marathon is really like something that people like actually race in, but you did a half marathon, correct?
I did.
How long is a half marathon? I don't have a clue. I don't even know how long a marathon is, so
Let's see. half marathon, it was 13.1 miles. And wow, that is a good 7 miles more than I'd ever ran in my life. So needless to say, I didn't really train for this like I should have.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Of course.
Because we talked about it, and I was going to do it. And then I was like, man, I just don't really have enough time. Like, I don't have... Because I'm trying to go to the gym a lot, too. Like, I didn't really have a whole lot of time to... And then it kind of put on the back burner. I kind of forgot about it.
Right.
Then, like, was like, all right, I got to do this. It's like, when I say I ran six miles before, that was, like, 2 months ago. And then I didn't run. So, like, the week up to the race, I ran, like, 3 a day.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, man. And I was like, if I have to walk it, I have to walk it. As long as I finish it. It's not like I'm, like, actually trying to get a good time. It's my first race. And so I get to Champaign Friday night. And the race is at 7 a.m. Saturday morning. And I stayed at my old roommate's place. When I texted him earlier that day, he said, oh, we're not doing anything tonight. I was like, sweet. So I can just, when I get there at like 10 or so, I can just fall asleep. No big deal. I get there. There's like 10 people in his living room just playing drinking games. And I was like, oh. So like, and I'm like, that's the couch I'm supposed to sleep on.
Right.
So like they all leave at like 12:30 or so, but then they all come back at like 2. So I only got like 3.5 good hours of sleep.
Oh boy.
So like wake up, go to the race, and I end up finding some people from work. But I was able to run the whole thing.
Nice. Awesome.
I took 3 naps Saturday after the race. Because I was really, really tired.
Oh, I can't imagine.
I was the hype man of our group. So like every time there's a camera or something, I would just like start hooping and hollering. And just being super obnoxious. I was that guy. Let me see. I'm going to send you on Facebook. This is, every time a camera pop came by, this was my face.
Oh, shit. That is too funny. Hold on. Let me see if I can.
Like, every time I could see every time I could see the camera, that was me. There's more, but that's like the only few good ones that came up on this little the photo thing.
Let me see if I can get this. where the heck? People can't see it. There you go. I'm overlaying that briefly on the stream. That guy on the right there is Tony Duna. That's too funny. That is great. anyways, congrats. That's an accomplishment, something that I couldn't have done, something that I haven't done. So good work on that. God damn it. Come on, work with me.
There we go. I started getting blisters at like mile 5 on the bottom of my feet. Oh. And I was like, this is unpleasant. And then I was like, then it got to like mile 9 or so. And I was like, man, I'm doing pretty good. But if I walk, I wouldn't start running again.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just like, I'm just going to go. And then if I have to pass out at the finish line, I just want to finish.
Yeah, it's a good strategy. It's impressive that you're able to keep it up, and you're very strong-willed. I've known that for a long time, so it doesn't surprise me that you're able to keep up with it. So, congratulations!
Oh, and thank you for the music suggestions. By the way.
Yes. So, what you ended up listening to? At least Animals as Leaders. Anything else?
As Leaders and the 10 Years Out.
Okay. Cool. Animals as Leaders is one of my favorites to listen to.
Yeah.
I just kind of like. Just listen to some good, like, technical musicians. Because that's what it is. Like, they're prog metal, but it's, like, very, like, intricate on the timing and the... It's great stuff. Big fan.
Yeah, when that album started coming on, because I didn't listen to any of the music you sent me until the race.
I just
put it in my playlist and went with it. And I was like, guys, this music my friend sent me is, like, crazy awesome. It's like... Like, imagine, like, jazz-level intricacy, but just hardcore.
Right. It's good stuff. Like, Gray actually recommended him to me at one time, and so that's how I learned about him. He sent me, and they don't have a bassist. It's just a guitarist.
Yeah, I saw that.
A drummer, and I think another guitarist. Now, on I think maybe the first two records, they still have bass recording, but it might be the third one, I think, or maybe it's the first two that don't, and the third one has it. One of them actually doesn't have bass on the record. The other ones, they actually have a, like, they, one of the dudes played bass just for the recordings, even though they don't have a bassist. But one of the records, they actually did it sans bassist and just, like, made sure all the guitars were thick as hell, and it, you can't even tell, like, because the guitars are so meaty.
That's crazy.
It's pretty crazy. Cool. I'm glad to have us back on the show. I'm glad that we've caught up. News is a little light today, just some stuff that we can sort of talk about to ease our way back. Some big news, actually. They don't really have articles for, because I'm assuming that hopefully you'll know it or not. If not, we can always look it up. But some bigger stuff that's been revealed recently. So let's go ahead and hit our news thing here. Sounds just like this.
Hey, I bought you some chips.
I'm not sure where I have that clip from Ross, like where I got it, but I've got it. Like, it exists, but I have no idea where I got it.
And I love that it exists.
What's unfortunate is that when I play it...
Hey, I bought you some chips.
I have no chips here, so what the hell, Ross? You son of a bitch. Where's my chips? I want them now. I'm hungry. First on the news list here. The Joker and Deadshot costumes have been revealed. Deadshot, I will put in quotation marks, but the Joker has been revealed for the Suicide Squad. So we'll start with the Joker. Have you seen the Joker?
I have.
Okay.
Like the official promo image released?
Yeah, where he's like,
is that what you're talking about?
Like this? Yeah. what are your thoughts on that sort of vibe that they have for the Joker so far? Because we don't really know much about the Joker, what he's trying to do with that character. So all we really have to go on is what they've released visually, or, you know, at least for their images. So
the little tattoo that says damaged on his forehead, I hate.
You don't like it.
I hate that one. I can deal with the other tattoos, but that one, I was just like, come on. Like,
yeah,
that doesn't feel like a very Joker thing to me. Like, he kind of looks like someone who's just like a big fanboy of the Joker,
right?
Not the actual Joker, like someone who's like one of his henchmen. But I mean, maybe in this movie he's not a big, like, major player yet.
Mm-hmm. It's possible.
So, I don't know. I'm still really excited to see it, but I was not all that thrilled.
Yeah, I'm sort of middle of the road with it, just because there's not much I can sort of glean from seeing that. You know, that I can make assumptions and say, well, that's a kind of a weird portrayal, so maybe it's going to be a weird portrayal in the film. But I don't know for sure. The tats things was kind of weird. Having damage on the forehead does seem a bit contradictory, just because I don't picture, you know. The Joker being a psychopath, is sort of, obviously he's incredibly narcissistic and he's only interested in himself and, you know, probably thinks very highly of himself. And to say that he's damaged, or, you know, to have that tattooed on his, just seems very like an emo thing, you know? And it's not that emo's bad if that's the way that your character's written, but I don't see the Joker ever not just having fun and thinking he's on top of everything. You know, so it just doesn't really fit the vibe that well. The laughter one was, you know, and the teeth, and it all was kind of like, interesting, but it all kind of made sense. So I guess we'll just have to see where that goes. They also released the Deadshot costume, supposedly, with Will Smith. Have you seen this?
It wasn't like officially released. Right. I think it was just a leak.
It was just photos off the set. Sorry. Where it's like him in the trench coat and the
whatever hat.
Yeah, like the duster hat that, you know, like cowboys
wear.
Very mixed feelings from myself on that one. A friend of mine, so, and this is the only like saving grace for it, is a friend of mine who's a huge fan of comics in general, and he much prefers Marvel. But his name's Phil, and he knows a little bit about DC, but he said that he thinks that it must be some sort of a flashback shot that they were working on.
Because
he was like, and I would agree with him to this extent. That is so far from the Deadshot that anyone was expecting that I don't think that that's the final costume. You know, maybe that's like a, here's young Deadshot when he was, you know, hustling dudes or something, or maybe it's going to be, for whatever reason, he's got a quote unquote disguise on that time. But, I'm thinking and hoping that that is not the final Deadshot costume and we just haven't seen it. Especially since it leaked, you know, maybe this week or sometime soon, at least we'll see, an actual Deadshot costume to sort of, quell the concern. Cause a lot of people are concerned. They're like, well, that's stupid. You know, not a lot of people are a huge fan of Will Smith in the first place, and see him in sort of this weird, like 70s gangster, you know, like pimp suit kind of thing. It's just like,
yeah,
like, what are you doing, man? Like,
I wanted he's got his little, he's missing his eye. He's got the targeting thing. I wanted that. Like, I wanted like a bunch of gear strapped around his chest. Cause I don't know.
I think they will go that route. I mean, if they don't, I mean, they're absolutely crazy, but I guess we'll just have to see what, you know, what happens from it. So so that was like half of the biggest DC news drop recently. The other half was the Batman versus Superman teaser was revealed. Of course, that also leaked originally, and then they were like, all right, well, I guess we'll just show you the actual teaser. And so then they dropped the teaser. What did you think about that? What did you think? I mean, I guess it's technically,
I don't think anything's actually leaked anymore.
Well, you think it's all intentional? All like them actually dropping it ahead of time just to sort of get their own hype
up? It's just kind of...
It's
just like, it's just too, like, every big trailer.
Right.
Is getting then released early. Mm-hmm. Like, there are these big companies. They can lock down some stuff.
Yeah, how did that guy get in with a cell phone? Like, I don't understand.
Like, I don't know. But who knows? Oh, well. It's out. I don't care. I don't care that if it was intentionally leaked or they leaked it themselves. I still got to see it, and I think I love it.
Yeah, I was a big fan. I saw it, and I was like, wow, this looks... Of course, I've always been on the side of, like, I really want darker portrayals of comics. That's why I wasn't, like, a huge fan of some of the Marvel stuff. A little too, like, comedy for me. But the way they did the trailer, at least. And had I told you that I watched Superman before we went on the break? I don't remember if we talked about that.
Sorry, you were breaking up.
Did we ever talk about watching Superman? I finally watched Man of Steel. I don't know if I ever mentioned
it. I don't think we did.
It was an okay movie. I'm not a huge fan of Superman as a character, but you know, very visually awesome. My biggest qualm with Superman has always been that he's invulnerable, and so you can never really truly, like, unless someone's got kryptonite weapons, be ever afraid that he's going to die or anything like that. And so it kind of pulls down my enjoyment level. But it's very, very interesting. Sort of interesting take on, like, him as an alien, you know, which you don't think of a lot, is that, no, that dude's extraterrestrial, technically, you know, and I thought that was very cool. To see sort of that tone pull over and, you know, the way that they're talking about with the whole Batman versus Superman and everyone seeing him as, like, a false idol, you know, it's just very cool take on it, and particularly liked, and then it just got made fun of after it released, which kind of sucks, but I really enjoyed Batman in his metal suit at the end and looking up at Superman. Do you bleed? And then you will. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's so freaking cool. And then everyone just made fun of it the next day. And they're just like, do you bleed? And there's like so many jokes coming after it. I'm like, oh, come on. That was like the coolest part of that trailer was Batman being a badass.
Ben Affleck is a giant.
Yeah, he is. Oh my gosh. Big Batman. Interesting is for his suit is he's actually got like the old Batman suit. Like not old as in like early, old as in like Batman old. Like his age. Like with the big, so it's
just Batman's the way been doing Batman things for a while.
Right, yeah. It's got the like the big bat symbol, not like the slim looking nice one. This one's like huge. I don't really know what era that's from, but
Frank Miller's.
Yeah, I did hear that they're pulling a lot from Frank Miller's The Dark Knight Returns story arc, because in that one, Batman and Superman fight, I believe, but it's for different reasons. So Superman, I think, ends up picking a fight with Batman because Batman, like Batman's whole thing is that he's got, at least with the Justice League, he's got a way to like kill everybody if he
wants to. Like a contingency plan,
right,
for everybody.
Because he's like, I don't know all of the Justice League, but he's one of, if not the only human people there who can just get stomped, mm-hmm, if everyone else was like got mind control and decided they wanted to kill Batman. So it makes sense that he would have these plans. And so I'm pretty sure in the Dark Knight Returns arc, I could be completely wrong. I haven't read it and I'm not for certain, but I think they fight because they have a disagreement on whether or not Batman should have these contingency plans or these methods. You know, should you have the kryptonite that could kill me? But in this one, they changed it. They changed the thing. Like the fight before, I'm pretty sure happened after the Justice League got started, obviously. And so this one is pre Justice League, and Superman is the one that's sort of inciting the fight, or at least like the thing that like Batman's bringing it to him rather than Superman bringing it to Batman. So definitely seems like it's pulling a lot from those arcs, but it's taking sort of a different path with it. Which will definitely be interesting. I'm excited. I'm again, can't really tell much from the trailer, but I think it'll be really cool to see where it goes, especially with Batman running around in a metal suit, fighting Superman.
The clip of him standing on top of the roof with the sniper rifle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it's just so cool. Now, one thing that I want to see, and I don't know if we'll see it in this one or not. I want to see agile, like, martial arts master Batman. When you watch the Nolan movies, and it's probably because of the suit, but Batman's very rigid. You know? Like, he's very, like, in order to turn his body, he has to, like turning his whole, like, head and his neck at the same time, and he, like, can't really fight people very much. You know, he's, like, very just moving at the elbows and... You watch, like, you know, a cartoon or you play any of the Arkham games or anything like that, and Batman, like, shreds dudes with martial arts. He's basically Bruce Lee. And I want to see... Yeah. I know that's not practical in a movie sense because you don't always get a... you don't always get a suit, a practical suit that looks awesome but also allows you to move like that. So I don't know if that'll happen, but that is something I've been dying to see. I want to see a Batman that can drop down, you know, make it out of a... I don't know, like a cotton or make it out of a cloth that like molds through the body, but maybe looks like it's because the thing about the Nolan Batman is he had like, it was like body armor. It was meant to stop bullets and stuff like that. I don't know if that's what Batman's normal shit does, stop bullets, but you know, I don't want to see the body armor. I want to see something a little more practical. So he can move around a little bit better, but who knows if we'll actually get that or if anyone else really has been caring about that.
I haven't read Dark Knight Returns, but I've watched the animated movies, Knight Returns Part 1 and Part 2.
Those I want to see those
movies, super well done. Like the Batman in that is like an older Batman, like in his 50s or 60s, gray hair, kind of had retired, but it just shows him just like be absolute merciless on bad dudes. Like to a degree where, like, the Nolan films are, like, just kind of silly. He's just, like, just destroys people. Like, throws people through walls, like, off buildings. Just, like, GTFO. I need some information, and you're going to give it to me. He's a scary dude.
Yeah.
That's how I hope they go.
I really want to see those, but I just haven't sat down actually watching it, especially since it's like a total of 5 hours to actually sit down and watch them. But I'm excited.
It's so, like two separate storylines, essentially. Right.
Yeah. I need to... I know I can watch them in parts. I need to watch one, and I'm sure that will spur me to watch the second. This isn't really news, but I thought it would be something cool that we could sort of engage in here. Microsoft dropped this... this is kind of dumb. It's really dumb. Let me just say this first off. It's stupid, but it's good dumb entertainment. Microsoft released a facial recognition website... where you can take a picture of yourself, and supposedly it's and its inner workings or whatever it's got behind the coding will try and gauge your age based on your face. So I don't know if your phone is nearby, but you can access the website via your phone just the same. I don't think it'll work on the computer just because we've already got our... webcams in use, but go ahead and go to the website. There's an option that says use your own photo, and then it should access your camera. And then go. I'm gonna have get our pictures taken here, and then see how old this thing thinks we are.
Oh geez. All right, headphones off.
All right, let's do that.
Oh yeah. That's a good. It's a good selfie. That's a good.
All right, so I've got it. Got the picture. Analyzing face. It always wants to show my face sideways for some reason. I don't know why. It like when it loads up. Okay, so do you have an age yet?
I do.
let me see if I can get this on camera. See, it wants to turn sideways.
35.
35 though is what it claims that I am. Let's see.
That's right.
27. That's not bad. Oh, that's funny. My friend, he has like a little figure on his desk at work. He was able to like zoom in and take a picture of like the face there, so it like recognizes like posters or anything else. I'm trying to think.
Let me try this again.
Let me see if I can get snakes.
I have a little Abraham Lincoln on this medal. Accurately guess his age. This is neat.
Yeah, I mean, except for the fact that it's like completely off in some circumstances, it's kind of a cool feature.
Yeah, that's bogus. Oh, it crashed. Redo.
Get snake.
Redo.
Come on, snake.
Is it snake? I want steak.
Snake. I'm using my snake model. All right, let's see. Let's see how old... He's got his night vision goggles on, so let's see if it registers him as a Cyclops. Analyzing. Couldn't detect any faces. Oh, well.
Oh. Yep, couldn't detect Abraham Lincoln either.
That's too bad. It does work on certain things. Oh, I have other figures over here that look even better. It does detect faces.
I'm going to make a duck face and see how it works.
It's actually going to remove like 10 years from your...
let's see. 28.
He's a year older. That is at how-old.net. So if you're sitting at home and you're like, hey, let's see how old I am. Go there. You can go on your phone. Just choose photo. Sarah says that she tried it with three different pictures and it couldn't recognize her face, so she must be a vampire. So yeah, little cool little tool. Obviously not that accurate, but still fun. Let's do a little bit of weird news here.
This just in. In other news...
Let's do two articles today. I've got four, but we're going to do two.
Let's do it.
Brewer replaces rugby player's missing teeth with bottle opener implants. An Argentinian beer company replaced rugby player's, multiple people, missing teeth with bottle opener implants as part of an ad campaign. The Salta beer ad, created by agency Agilvy Argentina, documented how the company teamed with an oral surgeon to reward players who gave everything they got on the field, including their teeth. Quote, "We decided to give rugby players back the teeth they had lost in battle, but we weren't going to give them a simple tooth back. We developed a unique dental implant, specifically designed tooth to open beer. Excuse me. The implants, which were installed by Dr. Sebastian Jury, bear the Salta brand name and were demonstrated to be working bottle openers by the patients at the end of the ad." That sounds incredibly painful. Like, to not the implant itself, but to be able to go, like, I don't know, this, man.
Yeah, you can use another bottle to open a bottle. You just, like, get it on there and just pop it, and it'll go. You don't need to have something in your tooth. A little, it'll look super badass, I am sure. But I don't know if it's necessary.
Well, because
and I feel like it'd be do more damage to your jaw because it's always putting that pressure. Right. You're just going to lose that again.
How many uses do you have before you rip the tooth back out? Speaking of which, I still not had my root canal done. They told me a while back that it was going to be May 21st, and if they had any openings, they'd get me in sooner, and they have not done so. So we're still looking at May 21st, although we're halfway there compared to what they told me last time, or where I was when I got the evaluation. So hopefully we can get that done and knocked out, and I can stop eating on one side of my mouth, which is what I've been doing for the last month.
That doesn't sound fun.
You know, I've gotten used to it, so I've kind of forgotten about it, but it is annoying. Hoping I can just stop eventually, because I'm sick of, like... Because I have to eat foods a certain way, you know? If I have, like, nachos, I have to do this weird, like, you put the whole nacho in, it's but then you, like, break it with your tongue and then try to fold it over and do all this. You have to, like, package it down just to get it on that side of the mouth. Kind of dumb. This article I saw posted otherwise. I think it was kind of in the news recently. Texas A&M professor fails the entire class for bad behavior. Texas A&M at Galveston professor failed his entire class after losing his patience with their bad behavior and academic dishonesty. Professor Irwin Horwitz sent the email to the students for his strategic management class, citing cheating, disrespect, lying, rudeness, and rumor mongering. Here is, I don't know if this is the entire email. But this is at least a part of it. Okay. So this is from the professor.
Okay.
"Since teaching this course, I have caught and seen cheating, been told to chill out, get out of my space, go back and teach, been called a blank moron," it just says expletive, "to my face, had one student cheat by signing in for another, one student not show up but claiming they did, listened to many hurtful and untrue rumors about myself and others, been caught between fights between students. None of you, in my opinion, given the behavior in this class, deserve to pass or graduate to become an Aggie," which I assume is like an alumni, "as you do not in any way embody the honor that the university holds graduates should have within their personal character. It is thus for these reasons why I am officially walking away from this course. I am frankly and completely disgusted. You lack the honor and maturity to live up to the standards that Texas A&M holds and the competence and or desire to do the quality work necessary to pass the course on a grade level. I will no longer be teaching the course, and all are being awarded with a failing grade." Horwitz acknowledged that not all of the students engaged in this behavior, but he failed them nonetheless. Quote,
that is baloney.
Hardcore.
That is super hardcore.
Quote here, "just ridiculous. I had never had that problem in the class. I thought I had done pretty well." This is from one of the seniors. "Just ridiculous. I never had a problem in the class. I thought I had done pretty well on the first test, and then I get an email saying I'm going to get an F in the class. It was just overwhelming. University has intervened." Quote, "None of them have failed until the end of the class, meaning the only reason a student would fail is because he or she has not performed the expectations for that particular class," the vice president of academic affairs said. Patrick Luchuarn or something, whatever that guy's name is. Luchuarn said that the university respects Horowitz, but none of the students will fail unless they fail to meet the academic standard for passing. I'm of two minds here. Hold on a second. I'm of two minds on this one because I hate kids. I hate college kids. They're stupid. They're stupid. I hate college kids.
You hate me?
So you're one of the good ones here. That like you know, the ones that didn't engage in, but they failed anyways. And I don't like, you know. There's just a lot of disrespect that comes to teachers and you know, just to other students, and it's real shitty. It's going to happen in a lot of places, but it seems to happen a lot in school because that's where you're just around more people. So part of me is like, you know what? Awesome. F those guys because they deserve it. Not the ones that didn't engage in the stuff, but you know, he should fail the other ones. Him failing the entire class, sucks, but I feel like it was basically a way to not discriminate. You know? Because if you say, you know what, I'm tired of this crap, I'm failing the ones of you who said this, you're gonna get people go, well, why did Billy pass and I didn't? I heard him say F gay people at one point, you know, like. And so he probably just was like, you know what, I'm failing everybody because I don't want to deal with it. I'm just failing everybody. And that's where I'm like, that can really screw up a college career. It's not fair to people who weren't involved. So that part I don't agree with. I don't know. I feel like the people who deserved it, yes. You know, I've heard stories from Rachel where she'll talk about students not showing up to class, not doing their volunteer work. You know, they have a class, they're supposed to volunteer 40 hours a freaking semester or whatever it is, they're supposed to do this many hours a week, and then they wait and there's 3 weeks left in the class and they try to knock out all 40 hours but they can't schedule it correctly, so then they come complaining to Rachel and say, well, I can't get my hours done because they won't let me work more than 5 hours a week. And we're like, hey, you dumb, it's like working me up, I'm not gonna I gotta censor my language here, but hey, you moron, what were you doing for the last, you know, however many weeks the semester's got? Like, kids don't take it seriously. I didn't take it seriously. I didn't take college seriously, and look where I'm at now, making an awful podcast, but I'm kidding.
First you say you hate me, and then you say all my work's for nothing.
Yes, I hate the podcast. I'll see your work. Absolutely worthless. No, but it just, I don't know. Kids are pampered and they don't think that, you know, they think that they deserve shit that they don't deserve, you know? Like I said, I've heard Rachel plenty of times talk about people coming up and being like, you know, can I get a pass on this, you know? Why should we give a pass to you on this? Were you trying everything you absolutely could to do to get it done and you just couldn't get it done? Okay, cool. Yes, pass deserved. But if you're not doing anything, if you're not contributing, if you're not trying, and then at the very end you realize, oh shit, I can't do this in the right amount of time. I need more time, or I need help. Screw that. You don't deserve it.
Yeah.
You don't deserve the help, and I don't think you should give it. But teachers are inclined to give it because what happens if they don't? Parents call the university.
Angry parents that are rich.
Right.
Like, hey, what about my son?
Your kid is trying to grow up and learn about the freaking world, and you always have to have your parent like butt in and say, well, my child's the greatest child in the world. He would never freaking not do his homework. And my parents were the exact opposite. They were always on the side of the teachers, and that's a good thing. Like, they were always like, Jake, what the hell are you doing? Like, they didn't defend me, you know? And it's good because the parents that sort of get in and defend and sort of stick up for the kid is nice in certain situations, but almost always bad in academic situations because the kid is a little shit and the parent just doesn't want to believe it. Sorry, my I'm off my soapbox there on that one. You're a good kid, Tony. I believe you're a good kid, and I don't hate you.
Well, thanks. I uploaded a different photo from 2 days ago when I had longer hair, mm-hmm. and I had my other glasses on.
46?
46. It's those glasses.
Oh, shit. It really is. They look like my dad's glasses.
That's why I got them when I got... These are my main pair of glasses.
Okay.
I've worn them on the show before, like, all the time.
Right.
And I bought those, and they were like, well, if you buy a second pair, you can get, like, this much dollars off. And I was like, what's the cheapest pair of glasses you have?
What would make me look like a grandpa? Give me those. It's
like, they're like, well, these are probably the cheapest ones, and they come with little safety things for the sides.
Right.
So I was like, well, I'll get those. And it was like, cost me like $20. I don't wear them often. It's more of kind of a gag. But they are actual prescription glasses, and I've worn them to work at Caterpillar before on accident.
Nice.
I just woke up, put the glasses on, got ready. Didn't realize they were my creeping glasses. So I got to work, and everyone was like,
oh, shit.
Real professional.
Oh, that's funny. I think they look nice in a sort of retro, you know, I'm 60 years old kind of way, but... all right, well, that's all we got for news. It seems to be a recurring thing that we just keep not having enough time for news, but we'll blow through a couple of would-you-rathers here. We're going to start out with a good one here. I usually like to ask very thought-provoking would-you-rathers because it's fun, but today we're going to just start off with the weird because that's what I want to do. I just want to be weird right now. Would you rather...
Let's just get weird, man. let's go get weird.
Would you rather... Oh, wait, hold on. We got to play something. Here we go.
A piece of that tip just got me.
Welcome to Would You Rather. Would you rather that your girlfriend leaves you for your dad or your best friend makes out with your mom? Which which one would you rather happen? Your girlfriend leaves you for your dad or your best friend makes out with your mother?
What if my girlfriend doesn't exist?
Okay, so assuming, hypothetically, would you rather a girlfriend... leave you for your father or your best friend make out with your mother?
I'd probably have to say best friend make out with the mother.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, that's like the other alternative is just like way more drama.
Exactly. Because like now you have to see her at like Christmas.
Would be an article that we would talk about on this podcast.
Making out with moms, that happens all the time. Come on. so, yeah. Best friend makes out with mom. I can deal with that. Off to a good start. All right, let's find something else here. Oh, wait. We got to figure out the percentages. All right, here we go. Okay. 58,000 people voted. 23% said that they would rather have their girlfriend leave them for their father. 77% said best friend make out with your mom. So it seems like other people are on the same page here. All right, let's go to the other end of the spectrum. Now we're just going to be morbid. If you had to choose one, would you rather be shot or stabbed?
I'm going to go shot.
Okay, why is that?
Both are going to hurt like hell.
Mm-hmm.
So why not do the one that's a better story?
Well, I don't know. Getting stabbed in like a knife fight's kind of crazy. Getting shot is just like...
Well, that's true.
I'm
assuming you lose this fight.
Right. Both have...
So I'd rather say like, yeah, I had a gun. I didn't.
I'm going to say... So Ross and Sarah both have said shot in the chat. They're not going to hear me now until a couple seconds, but explain why. But... Shot or stabbed. I don't know. I guess maybe shot, just because I feel like it would be over with quicker. Assuming it goes through me and doesn't hit any vital organs, maybe. And same thing with the knife.
I would rather the bullet get stuck in me.
What? Then go all the way through?
Through and through is like way more blood. You're losing way more blood.
Yeah, but then you don't have to be opened up on a surgical table.
What?
Then you don't have to be opened up on, like, surgery, and they have to, like, extract the bullet from you. I mean, they'd still probably have to patch you up a little bit from a through-and-through shot, but...
Where are we getting shot? Like gut? Getting stabbed in the gut? I don't know. That's a good question. Maybe. Let's just do both.
Yeah, I'll take both. That'd be pretty badass. I got knifed in a knife fight and then shot by that same guy in a shootout later.
See, I made the mistake. I brought a knife to a gunfight. He took my knife and then shot and stabbed me. She was very mean.
Let's see. All right. Well, what did you say? Shot or stabbed?
Wait. Shot.
Okay. I'm going to pick shot as well. We're going to take the plunge here. Wow. Incredible. 70,000 people voted. 86% said that they would rather be shot. 14% said that they would rather be stabbed. One of the comments here, and I don't even know if this is true. It sounds like just, you know, dependent on the situation, but it says you're more likely to survive being shot than stabbed. I don't know about that, unless you're talking about, like, point of entry, because a bullet hole, I think, would be maybe depending on what you get stabbed with as well, though, I guess. It really depends. It's, like, so
vague. Are we getting stabbed by katana?
Right.
That could tear your insides up. Or like this little knife. Like a shank.
Oh, pig sticker. Let's see. Some of these are just mean. Would you rather? Alright, let's go one more page. Move on to our
Would you rather here. Catch my drift or pick up what I'm putting down?
I would rather pick up what you're putting down.
I'd go the same way.
Okay, here we go. Here we go. Would you rather have no water or no internet connection? So let's say it's like a week or whatever. Oh. You have to go without one. You either have no water in the house. Or like, okay, so no water coming from like the pipes or anything. No water at all. I'm going to say no water at all. Or no internet at all. So for a week, you have to go without one.
I would be dead without water for a week. So, well, I could do without internet for a week.
Yeah, I could probably find it. Well, shit. I was going to say, well, just watch Supernatural for that week. But no, that doesn't... Unless I have to order the DVD set from Amazon the week before.
You have to prep.
No. Yeah, I could manage it because I have enough things on DVD and stuff. I could watch Seinfeld or something like that. Shit, I could actually play video games offline. I don't actually have to play online. I could go with no internet connection. Water would just get kind of weird after a week.
Yeah. You get super dehydrated, probably start hallucinating.
All right, cool. Well, that was Would You Rather.
I got one for you.
Go ahead.
Would you rather work as a DJ that's only allowed to whisper or a funeral director who's only allowed to yell?
DJ that's only allowed to whisper. Because I would make it my thing. Like, that would be like, DJ Whisper! And I'd come in and back. Like, so you couldn't do that. Oh, well, I wouldn't be the guy. That would be like the MC, like, pumping me up.
Drop the bass.
And then, I would make that my thing. But as a funeral director, I mean, I guess that could be your thing as a funeral director. Like, come see the amazing shouting funeral director. And he just.
You could be like, I mean. I mean, those southern churches.
Yeah, I mean,
you're like
Baptist.
Oh yeah, I get an amen.
Yeah, I mean, you could definitely make it work either way. I guess I would still go with whispering DJ, because maybe I just wouldn't talk then. Although, I don't know. No, I don't know. I would still go with whispering DJ. I would figure it out. That brings us to our first break. And as I said before, kill the jazz. We have, the guy who helped to write the intro piece in the beginning. who wrote actually most of it. Basically, I was like if that music piece, if our intro was a film, I was the director and he was the writer. So it was a lot of me, of him like writing it, putting it down, composing it, getting it together, and me saying, yeah, this is how I want it to sound and stuff like that. So he did all the work, and I basically just told him what I wanted it to sound like. So props goes to him mostly. Casey, thank you for doing that. But his name on SoundCloud, and his name is creator, is Electric Ocean. So we have two songs that we're going to play. This is the first one. This is called Pacific Voltage. Really cool song. No vocals or anything like that. So it's just sort of an electronic instrumental. When we come back, we will have Ross Bays. And what seems to be some good stories to hear from him. So we'll be back.
You a Satanist, huh? Then you wrote a book too, then, right? You got a book with blood on it, huh? You Satan, huh? Who created your ass, Satan? Who created your ass? I come in the name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. The devil is a motherfucking liar. So you know I ain't worried, bitch. Stupid bitch. Look at that. I'm provoking that, huh? That I'm making motherfuckers just hate God more. I'm provoking that, huh? You goddamn devil worshiper, you ain't got no excuse. Motherfucker, you ain't coming in no, you come in the name of Satan. I guess if you like a house nigga and want to go competitive, if I say I'm God, then I guess you have to take the side of Satan, huh, motherfucker? Stupid bitch.
You have been listening to a Fly Science Productions podcast.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I love that clip because it's just sort of like I think they called it the ghetto preacher, but it's just funny that it's, you know, preaching in any kind of way you want. I mean, you got people who get excited and people who don't, and obviously that guy gets a little more excited than most and taking a different approach. Comes in the name of Mother Effing Jesus Christ or whatever he said. Oh, that was funny. I really wanted to capture him saying stupid bitch, but I didn't know what the application would be. Like, I was like, when would I ever play that? It's hilarious to hear him say it, but I wouldn't have anywhere to, like, play it that would really not be offensive every time anyone ever heard it. Well, I guess we can call Ross on at this point, I guess, if we have to.
I guess.
Well, let's go ahead and get this man on there. Oh, Ross Bays. Let's go ahead and add him to the call and play his theme music while I shuffle stuff around. Here we go.
Ross is, you know, distinguished, got his big old beard.
It's not going to be easy, but it will be worth it.
There's amazing things going on every day.
I may not be good, but I'm expensive.
It's Ross and I, and then a bunch of women. Don't let society tell you what to do. He has the power.
Brony.
Welcome back to the show. How you doing, Ross?
What's up, fellas? Everything sounds pretty tasty today.
Showing us up for looks.
He's gotten a little fancier. He let that finale episode get to his head. And now
I did.
Now he can only wear the suit. It's
in the hide.
Well, gee, I don't think any of us have really talked since the finale episode. We had a good time and,
we got sick of each other.
Right. Well, you know, and it's, unfortunately, that's part of like the sort of detox process, you know, as we spend every weekend together, every Saturday morning. And, when it comes to just relaxing, sometimes that involves just not talking. And I think I talked about it on the show before when I was young and I heard these people on the talk shows and I was like, they must be best of friends. They must talk 24/7. And then you're like, well, that would make for bad radio because they wouldn't have anything to say. So part of the, you know, sometimes just not talking is just because you want to have better shit to talk about when you get back to put on the show. So really what we're doing, I mean, we are sacrificing our relationship as friends so we can put it on display for everyone else. And hope that it's entertaining enough, at least. I will say real quick, I was checking the website during the song. Awesome song, by the way. I'm really like his music. I'm like kind of jealous. We have a lot more clicks on our Twitch page today than we normally. Usually we have a split, like Twitch and then MixLR, and a lot more people checking out the Twitch page today. So if you are checking out the Twitch page, you know, sign up for an account so you can chat and get with us on the chat in the program. Thank you to Ross for helping keep everybody involved whenever we're in the middle of
discussing ham.
you brought it up.
I'm excited, you know, because all of my favorite podcasts I've listened to always have a chat room, and I always felt like, you know, it would really be nice if we had a better way to interact with people. And, you know, we can shout out to John Rambo, my buddy, who, you know, before there wasn't enough of a...
You know Rambo?
Did you say John Rambo?
You know Rambo?
Wait, is John Rambo the actual Rambo guy's name? Is that his first name John? I've never seen Rambo, so I don't have a clue. No, I know a John Rambo that isn't Rambo, or at least isn't Sylvester Stallone. I was talking to John Rambo in Vietnam the other day.
Me and Ross were both like, you know Rambo?
No, that was...
Bill first.
Unrelated. And before he had mentioned it, you know, there wasn't like a huge demand. I know we have listeners, but a lot of people will sort of listen after the show. And it's kind of one of those things where you're like, why haven't we done it sooner? Because I've talked to Ross and I've talked to Tony and I've said, damn, guys, like I really want a way that we can interact with the crowd better with the show. And we've talked about running the Twitch page, but it just, you know, it soaks up all that bandwidth. And sometimes we have a hard enough time keeping our internet open just so we can run the damn show by itself. Lo and behold, it was super, super simple. Should have implemented it a long time ago, but now we have it. So we have the chat room. Make sure you get in. And if you're listening to this show after, if you're not listening live and you downloaded this later on, F you and tune in live. Yeah. wake up earlier, tune in. And
come play with us.
Yeah. I think you have to make a Twitch account, but that's it. And then you can just talk in the chat. And Raj chills before the show and... Sarah sticking it out today, so thank you for that. Ross, you have stuff to tell us. Hello. At least it appears that way.
I mean, it took the month off, you know, like everybody else did, and I guess in that month nothing too crazy happened.
Which is kind of a good thing.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's good to have the downtime, you know, quo. Spend lots of times with no pants on, which is always a plus. The two biggest things that happened for me were, one, I got promoted in jiu-jitsu again, which was nice. So
nice.
I am officially halfway to my blue belt, which would signify that I am ready for a street fight.
Nice. That's as if you weren't ready for a street fight prior to this. I mean, like, I understand ready for street fight in jiu-jitsu, but if I saw Ross coming down the street, I wouldn't go, that dude doesn't have his blue belt. I'm going to fight the shit out of him. I would be like, no, that's the last guy I'm fighting. Where's Rachel? You want to fight? Like, I would pick a fight with Rachel before I'd pick a fight with Ross.
That's good to know. All right. So, I mean, yes. But see, and this is what I told my wife. This is what I worry about. Most people at some point in their life have been in a fight. You know, okay. It's shoving each other and, you know, you're pulling your shirt off for no reason and just stupid stuff. But, like, the majority of my fighting experience came from the Marine Corps. So, like, they taught me how to, like, step on somebody's neck and, you know, kick somebody in the tooth. But, like, that's not something that you do when somebody's talking at the movie theater and gets out of hand. You know what I mean? So,
right.
The idea behind the jiu-jitsu
is exactly what you do.
I told you about that cell phone.
In that movie theater again.
Right.
Problem solved.
It kicked him in the tooth.
I don't see anything wrong with that. I don't.
But, Sarah, I do have pants on today. Oh, I'm sorry. I let the audience down. But tune in next week. We'll see. But
that's our hook for everyone tuning in to Karmafied, is they're going to be like, I wonder if he's wearing pants this week.
No pants. So the idea behind jiu-jitsu is that they're teaching you how to control a situation without getting out of control and whatever else. So when you get promoted to your second stripe and you hit that halfway point, you're allowed to join these reflex development classes, which are basically an hour-long fight. You've got mouth guards and gloves and you're just like going at each other for a solid hour. And it was miserable.
I mean, can't imagine.
You know, I'm with a guy that's bigger than me, because that's the idea behind jiu-jitsu. You're able to control someone that's bigger and stronger than you are. So that was a rough experience. But it's kind of what's necessary. You know, you have to learn how to get beaten. You have to learn how to be in very uncomfortable situations for long periods of time just so you know what the worst scenario feels like.
Right.
But other than that, I mean, that was pretty much the majority of my month. In other news, I am taking the entire month of June off of video games.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to hear that.
That's devastating. And what sparked that was, you know, my wife is starting her fourth year of of the, you know, the, of grad school, and mm-hmm. she decided with a friend that they're going to take the month of June off of TV altogether, get back to real life and reading books and going outside and that kind of crap.
Gross stuff.
What?
There's like pollen outside.
Spiders.
You can't mess with that.
So I said, okay, well, if you're gonna do no TV for a month, then I'll take the hit. I'll do no video games for a month. So we'll see what happens. I'm sure the first week I'll be back into it. So
that's a good opportunity. It's I think it'll be fun.
Are you gonna do any training for this? Like, kind of like wean yourself off, or are you just going cold turkey?
Cold turkey. I'm not going to make any longer than I have to.
Oh, boy.
That's going to be miserable. So today I want to try something new with Karmafied.
Okay.
I wanted to tell a story that, and I'm sure everybody that has lived more than a day has had like one of the most embarrassing things happen to you.
Okay.
And you. Me, I'm a pretty vulnerable guy, and I'm out there, so I wanted to share one of my most embarrassing stories.
Was this something that happened recently, or something that's...
Oh, no, God, no. No, oh, okay. I needed time to get over this one.
I was like, damn, did we miss the most embarrassing thing that ever happened in the last month? Like, we should have been doing the show, but...
No, this was when I was 16 or 17 years old. But it was a very interesting experience. So I wanted to kind of throw this at people, and feel free to share your most embarrassing moments, or maybe it's not as bad as I remember, but I'll let the audience be the judge. So I am 16 years old, and I had just started going to church. And if you've ever gone to church and gone for an extended period of time, you start to learn that the church has like a hierarchy of people. Like mm-hmm. there's a family that's really, really important, and everybody knows this family. And, you know, there's like a ranking system in the church kind of thing. So I remember sitting in church when I'm 16, 17 years old. We'll just say 16 for the sake of the story. And I see this girl across the church that I cannot take my eyes off of. Oh. Just this beautiful brunette giving me the, you know, and I can't help it. Just the bat in the eyes. And I managed to gain up the courage to talk to her. Even though I'm new in the church, I don't know anything about anything. She's gorgeous. I got to talk to her.
It's reason enough.
Super. But, yeah, why not? You know, I'm wearing pants today. Why else?
There's a low pollen count.
Right.
It's going to be a good
day. So I go and I start talking to her, and we kind of hit it off. And before you know it, we start, you know, I don't want to say dating because we're not actually going on dates, but we become boyfriend and girlfriend.
Right.
And it was kind of weird because she was really into the church. Like, she had been going to church since she was 3, and I was brand new and knew nothing about anything. Like, I knew there was God and there was Jesus, and everything else was just kind of, I don't know. So I had to learn.
It's in the book somewhere.
I haven't read it yet, but I'll figure it out. And so I start going through the church process and learning the stuff. And then all of a sudden, one day, I get a phone call on the landline, because that's how we old folks. And her name was, well, I'll change the names to protect the innocent. Her name was Amy. And so Amy's dad calls me on the phone. And he says, hey, Ross, are you busy today? Would you like to go for a drive?
Oh, jeez. No, I'm like already nervous.
Terrified. And so at the time, like, this guy is one of the ushers. He's always wearing a suit and tie. And he kind of looks like a 55, 60-year-old Beavis, just to give you some visualization. Okay? And as soon as he calls me, and I know he's coming over the house, I rip down all my Nirvana posters and all my Kurt Cobain pictures, because I know that's not allowed in the church world, right?
Right.
He's going to come in and, like, you know, investigate the house to see if I'm living like a Christian kind of thing. So I tear down my whole room and stuck everything in the closet. And he gets to the house and he walks through the door and says, hey, Ross, let's go for a drive. Let's just have a chat. I'm like, oh, man, this is going to be like some mafia stuff where he threatens my life. You know, I've got a horse head in my bed. And so I get the car with him. We start driving, and there's like this long 10-minute pause, really awkward, and I'm feeling it. I'm sweating already. And he says, "So, Ross, how long have you been going to church now?" I said, "Well, sir, I've been going for about 3 months." He said, "Okay, and I understand you and my daughter are a bit of an item." "Sir, yes, she is my girlfriend." Right. "Well, whatever, trying to play the card." And he says, "Well, Ross, have you ever heard the term unequally yoked?" I'm like, "I've never heard that." And he said, "Well, basically what it means, in so many words, and I don't want to insult you, but you seem like a smart young man," backhanded comment, here it comes. And he goes, "Well, unequally yoked means that my daughter is a very strong Christian, very strong in her walk with God, and you don't know anything. So, in other words, you are not good enough for my daughter." And I'm like, "Gosh!" I mean, my heart breaks. You know, like, I don't even, like, really know this girl too well yet, but
yeah.
What he's telling me is devastating to me because right. It's embarrassing, you know? So he says, "Okay." And I said, "Well, I'm learning. You know, I'll learn stuff as I go." And he says, "Okay, well, tell me this. What does being a Christian mean to you?" I'm like, "Oh, God." And I know that's one of the most basic questions you can ask somebody.
Right.
So I'm like, it means being nice to people and always saying please and thank you and helping people. And that's what I gave, you know, which is not the right answer at all.
Right.
So he took out a Bible as he drives. We ended up driving around for a couple hours.
Oh, okay? Shit.
He puts the Bible in my lap and says, "Okay, turn to the book of Matthew in chapter 13. And I'm like, "Ugh." So I don't even know where this book is, right? I'm just flipping through pages. I don't know what I'm doing. And after 2 hours of me reading passages from the Bible and like trying to engage in this conversation, it was clear when I got out of the car, this guy wanted nothing to do with me at all.
Dang.
So every single time that I went to church after that was a very, very awkward time because this guy's giving me daggers and you can tell, you know, he's trying to keep Amy away from me. And when I say that this is a Christian family, I mean that the parents had 8 kids at the time because they said that the more kids they had, the more kids that would be involved in church and could spread the word of God. So that's a lot of kids. That's a lot right. of commitment to.
Yeah.
Now, nothing against it. I'm just saying that's kind of the context.
Right, sure.
And so with 8 kids, all these kids love me. And they were always hanging all over me. And I'm great with kids, so it's all good. But the dad was not having it. After dating this girl for about 6 months, he comes up to me and says, "Ross, I see that you're trying. You still have a long way to go in my eyes. But I would like to have you over for dinner." All right. So we're making some progress.
Yeah.
I go over to dinner at their house, and I dress in the shirt and tie, and I'm looking good, and I made sure I put on deodorant that day, put on some pimp cologne, and I'm sitting there at the table, and you would think that with 10 family members, 8 of them being kids, and me, it's a loud, boisterous kind of conversation. Nothing. It is silent. You can hear the occasional fork scrape across the plate. And they say grace at first, right? Which almost ends up being one of those moments where people are like, "Ah!" and start crying and falling right. over the table. Like, it was chaos, right? And so we start eating. And everything's good. And I'm trying to like, sir, this steak is fantastic. Thank you for making it. Please pass the ketchup, you know, like trying to play the young man role. And still, like, nobody's engaging in conversation, which isn't a big deal. Like, if I just stay quiet and, you know, look presentable and make sure I don't have boogers hanging out of my nose, I should be okay. As long as through dinner, maybe I'll make a good impression and everything will be good. And all of a sudden, as I'm sitting there, embraced in the silence, I feel my stomach kind of like, and I was like, "Oh, like something's wrong." Okay. I immediately start sweating. Now, I'm the kind of guy, I don't like going to the bathroom in other people's houses. I just right. don't dig it.
Yeah.
I want to be home where I can lock the door, put all the couch cushions up in front of it, and just have my own privacy.
stomach starts
retaliating against me for whatever reason. You know, maybe it was the gallon of chocolate milk that I drank earlier that I realized, like, there's no getting around this. Like, we're not even halfway through the meal yet, and I have an emergency happening. So I finally gain up the courage to be like, will you excuse me? Please excuse me from the table. I need to go to the restroom. And they're like, oh, absolutely. The bathroom's right there. And as I look over, the bathroom is attached to the kitchen. Who does that way? So get up, and I'm, like I said, I'm sweating. Like, I've got pancakes under my armpits. I'm terrified. And I, so I get up, and I'm trying to keep my butt clenched, and I start waddling towards the bathroom. And as I cross the kitchen floor, there's that linoleum, you know. Mm-hmm. I realize as I close the bathroom door that there's like this much space under the door.
Oh, my gosh.
This will come into play later on in the story. So I get into the bathroom, and I lock the door, and just for some kind of subterfuge, I turn on the faucet, full blast, just so they can't hear what's happening.
Sure.
This chaos, right? So I drop my pants on the sit down, and I just give birth to this monster. Now, you said you like Monster Hunter stories. So here I am, I'm sweating, and I'm twitching, and I've got the sink on full blast, and I'm dying, right? And I'm trying to make no noise whatsoever. It's not happening. So I try to get as fast as possible because everybody knows the longer you're in the bathroom, the more obvious it is that you're having a hard time. Right. Right? Well, I'm like, okay, I got to hurry. Okay, do my business. And I stand up, flush the toilet, and I start washing my hands. And as I'm washing my hands, right out of the corner of my eye, I catch some movement. Okay, and I'm like, and I look over, and this thing has made its way out of the bowl and is just spinning around, just chaos.
Oh my gosh. Oh
my God, and the water is rising. Okay, and I don't know what to do because I've already flushed the toilet. They have heard me flush the toilet. This is what's going on in my head, right? I can't flush it again. They're going to know that chaos has erupted.
Right.
Of course, like, what do you start looking for first? The plunger.
Right.
No plunger. No plunger, not like a drumstick that I could, you know, kind of...
Just do battle. Back demon.
Had to happen, you know. Monster Hunter galore. So I start panicking, and I'm like, okay, well, I don't know what to do. The water's rising, and this thing is, like, out of the bowl. So I push the seat down and just try to collapse it and smother it.
Oh, my gosh.
See, it's just ugly. So in a moment of panic, I reach into the bowl and grab this thing and start snapping it like a stick. Right? Oh. It into bite-sized pieces, right? Like, come on. It was like Saving Private Ryan.
Okay? Oh, my gosh.
Choice. So I'm breaking this thing up, and finally I flush it again because I have to, although I did consider just like taking it all out and putting it in the back of the toilet. Because I'm like, hey, they're not going to think it's me.
Right.
And I flush the toilet. Everything's good. Okay. Give it a good scrub. Slam the door open. Nobody pays me any mind, right? Nobody looks at me. Nobody, like, no suspecting or whatever. And so, okay, it's been a few minutes. I kind of waddle back out there, and I sit down. Everything was good. We get through the meal. Then dessert comes up, and dessert, ironically, was chocolate cream pie, which I will remember because of the scenario. But what's funny is I'm sitting there, and we're silently eating our chocolate cream pie. I look down and realize that my fingernails are stuffed to the rafters, right? And I'm like, oh, come on. But the thing was, I'm sitting there, I'm like, is that pie? Okay, good. Now squeeze it out, you know, put it on the tablecloth.
Right.
Just save the situation altogether. And Tony, your face is killing me right now. Oh, that's great. I got to watch that one again when this is done. But so anyway, so we finished with dinner, we finished with dessert, and I end up leaving that afternoon with a pretty good feeling, like, I think I'm okay. Nobody noticed. I think, you know, the mom and dad are into me. I didn't misbehave. And it was a couple months later when Amy and I broke up, unrelated, right? I'm in church, and her dad comes up to me, and he says, hey, I hope that there's no hard feelings between you and the family. Things didn't work out with you and Amy. And I said, no, sir, it's all good. I mean, we made a mutual decision to break up. It just didn't work out. Maybe you were right. We were unequally yoked, yada, yada, yada. And he laughed, and he said, well, you're a good young man. I'm glad that we got a chance to meet. You got a chance to know the family, and the kids love you. And then he says, and by the way, I know you destroyed the bathroom that day. And I was like, what? I didn't say, like, how do you know that? But I went flush, beat red, started sweating, and then walked away, and I never saw him again.
Oh, my gosh.
So now, anytime that I'm at somebody's house just from that day, if I feel like badness, I'm out. No, boom. If I have to.
Oh, that is too funny. That is so. Oh, yeah, and by the way, I know you destroyed the bathroom. Oh, my gosh. What?
Yeah. So, yeah, one of those things you just kind of have to throw out there.
That is a story that what I'm going to do now is when we get the video show up on YouTube, I'm going to say, hey, I'm going to send it to my friends and say, if you don't listen to the show, at least watch this 20 minutes here. And watch Ross's story, because
you gotta watch Tony's face as I'm telling it. It was when I looked at you with the fingernails, and you were like,
"Oh man, that is too funny."
That is something I am terrified of, which is why if I had taken number two, I'll go for it. But people are already gonna know that I'm what I'm doing, just because quick poops. Or elusive. Come by. So if I can't be fast, I will do two flushes. I will flush halfway through, and like once the turd hits the water, flush. That's the last time it's sitting there stinking up the bathroom.
Yeah,
like that flushes the smell away, and then you clean up. And then you get two flushes. They already know what you're doing.
Put it all in the back of the toilet.
Oh, my gosh.
No flushes.
We've got a bathroom downstairs connected with our kitchen area, and I think it's the worst design choice in the house. I hate it. I'm like, for taking a number one, whatever. You can hear it. You kind of know what's going on. That's fine. But, like, when I sit down, I want to be comfortable. Don't want to be interrupted. I don't want to think that someone is outside eating a salad three right. feet away from where I'm trying to take a dump. Like, I just want to relax, you know? And sometimes it's not easy when you're, like right there in the kitchen. Who thought, like, okay, what do we need here? We've got the refrigerator, the oven, we've got the countertop here. But there's no shitter. Where's the toilet? I don't see the kitchen toilet. It's nowhere to be found. Yeah, okay, fine, put a door on it. Like, they just... I don't know, but that's great. I'm glad that you were able to tell us that story, because
at Caterpillar, when I first started at Caterpillar, like a place of business, any public bathroom, you try to tend to be quiet.
Mm-hmm.
That is not the case at Caterpillar. I was bewildered. I went to a stall and just it's like bombshells going off around me. I'm like. What? But like, kind of like they just sit down and just let her loose. Groans, it echoes. I'm like, what is going on? I was like, well, okay then. So then I'm just starting letting loose. But like, it kind of makes sense because to them, like, I'm only part time. Like, my job is not that important. But they're like, time is money to them. So they just gotta
get it out.
Yeah. I mean, you are in the bathroom, though. You know, that's what it's for, but...
Right.
Yeah.
In most of the bathrooms, if there's, like, five people going to the bathroom, everyone's pretty quiet. Yeah. Not causing commotion.
Don't want to be that first guy.
No. Everyone is that guy.
That's funny.
I thought about that. You know, like, you're going into the bathroom, and you're trying not to let people know that you're shitting. But people know! They see your feet! They see your pants around your legs!
See, that's why when I go in the stall, I just kind of...
you do the iron cross.
Right.
You work on your core.
Oh, right. Man. It's just, and so now I'm less worried about it. And, you know, it's kind of a courtesy issue. I mean, you don't want to, like, just be making tons of noises, and I generally don't. But, no, it dawned on me one day. I'm like, you know, I'm trying so hard to be quiet. You know, it's like showing up to dinner and then not eating. Like, you're there to eat, but you don't want to eat because you're like, disrespectful. Like, no, that's what you're there to do. That's what you're in the bathroom to do. You're in there to take a dump. And it's going to make sounds.
Between dinner and pooping.
Right. Chocolate cream pie.
Depending right. on your preference. Well, thank you, Ross. Thank you for coming on and sharing. It was a great story to come back on. next week, we will have more to talk about with the general show and with Karmafied, perhaps. A little more along our usual lines. Wanted to make sure today was sort of a very nice, relaxing return to form for us. Go ahead and, you know what, I don't feel like editing the feed right now, so Ross, you want to sit with us while we announce out the show?
Sounds good.
All right, ways to help out the show. If you're listening in today and you thought, you know what, start of season 2, episode 51, it's kind of great, kind of cool. Talk about us on Facebook. Share the posts. Make a post with our website or the link to the show or even the YouTube video. Tell people why you like us. Tell people what we are. One of Tony's friends commented on one of our posts recently and was talking about how we don't really know what to describe the podcast. And it's kind of hard sometimes because we're just a general talk show. We talk about a lot of things.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you get a lot of people like, oh, what's your podcast? Oh, well, we talk about comics, or we talk about video games, or we talk about tech, or we talk about, you know, whatever. And it's like, well, we talk about all of that. We talk about movies. We talk about, you know, things going down in the Middle East. We talk about, you know, like, we've got a wide variety. So you usually just say general talk show, but tell people, say, hey, you know, Stream the Machine is a entertainment show, you could call it, weekly news entertainment and comedy news, I don't know, whatever, just make it up. Let people know what we are. If you want to sponsor a segment, you can find out more about that on our website. Big thanks again to my sister, both sisters actually, Jen and Renee, for the sponsorship on our finale episode, helping out with the show. It's amazing. If you want to support us more than just listening and sharing on Facebook, you can go to patreon.com/streamthemachine. There, you don't even have to really donate. You can become a donator if you'd like, or you can just become a supporter, and just help us out. Share it with other people and let us know, you know, why you're a fan of the show. Email in your music, or if you know somebody that has music, get them to email it in or email us in their music. Love playing local stuff on the show, and by local I mean anything that I'm not grabbing off of a royalty-free site. Like stuff we got today. We've got great music today, and I'm glad to play it, and I like getting the Ross in the supervillain pose there. I like being able to give people credit where credit is due. You can find me on Twitter at RedefineJack, although I haven't been on Twitter in a while. I kind of got back up on it, and then when we took the week off from the show, or the month off from the show, I just kind of wasn't on it. Tony DePalma is at TonyDePalma51. Ross is at RealRossBase. Correct? Yeah. I have to ask that every time. The show Twitter is at STM Podcast. There you can see when our YouTube show gets uploaded. So if you don't tune in live, you can figure out there. Just stay tuned. your website is streamthemachine.com. There you can listen to. I'm actually going to separate. So I think I have things separated by years. So it's 2014 shows and 2015 shows. I'm actually going to group everything from season one into season one now. Get rid of the year marker. And just have season one, and then following will be season two and all the episodes after that. But you can listen to past shows there, comment on the shows if you like a particular one. I want to thank everybody for the help. Thank you guys for coming back. I wasn't sure if I'd have you both when I came back here doing a solo show or not, but everyone came back, and we're here on our reunion, starting off another great year. Thank you, Tony, for being an awesome co-host. Thank you to Ross for always bringing great stuff to the show. Next week... First episode's already over. That's crazy. Next week, second episode of season two. I'm conflicted because since we're calling them seasons, it's easier just to call it, oh, it's episode two, but it's episode 52. So I'm going to try and keep calling them by how many there actually are. 10:30 Eastern, 9:30 Central. sound off on the comments today, guys, whether it's on the website or on the show or on the Facebook page. Let us know how you felt about our return and feedback. And it's always welcome. Thank you for tuning in. Make sure that you tune into the chat. What else is there to say? I guess I should just sign off and play some music. That's about it. All right, cool. this is Electric Ocean again. The song is called What's Wrong. If you want to listen to more by Electric Ocean, let me figure out what the SoundCloud link is. SoundCloud.com/electric and then the letter O. Sorry, the letter O, the number zero, and then C-E-A-N. So Electric Ocean, but the O is spelled with a zero. He's got a bunch of cool stuff up there, including the Stream the Machine remixes and some other demos that he hasn't fully released yet. Very good music up there. Love almost everything he's done. I think there's one or two tracks I'm not super keen on, but the rest of it is absolutely amazing. So thanks, Casey. This is What's Wrong by Electric Ocean. Ross and Tony, I'll see you guys next week.
Later.
Have a good week, everybody. Took the mute off just a second too early because then someone like drove by and honked their horn really loudly.
Really?
I was like, what assholes? It's like, doing a show in here. But, oh, man.
Oh, alrighty, well.
We'll get back to the normal stuff a little bit more next week. Kept today pretty light because I figured it would just be easy and relaxing.
Yeah.
So. All right, homie. I'll catch you next week. And congratulations again on the half marathon. That's awesome. That's good stuff.
Thanks.
It's one of those things that, you know, should be proud that you've done. And I don't know. It's really cool, though. So good work.
Thank you.
All right, homie. I will see you next weekend.
Later.
See you all.
Thank you, everybody, for tuning in today.